For this section, we are going to discuss the product rule and the quotient rule for taking derivatives. So up to this point, we have the ability to take the derivative of something like this, like 3x to the fifth minus 7 over x plus 5 to the x plus 3e to the x minus 11. So this is the type of a function we have the ability to take the derivative of. I mixed in a few different things, some power functions, x to the fifth, 1 over x. I mixed in some exponentials and a constant. So just as a quick little review, let's just take this derivative because we're going to use these skills today. So to take this derivative, dy dx would give me 15x to the fourth. This minus 7 over x, I should have done a little rewrite on this one. This is minus 7x to the negative first. So doing a rewrite, as we've discussed quite a bit in the previous section, we spent a lot of time talking about how if it's not given to us in that power function form, then we take a moment to do a rewrite. That was the only one that needed a rewrite, so I'm going to just write it right there instead of rewriting the whole function. So we've got 15x to the fourth, we will have a positive 7x to the negative 2. Now this little 5 to the x, just as a reminder, over here, we discussed it, and it was a little beyond the scope of our textbook, but I did throw it in there when we talked about exponentials, so we have talked about it in this course. When I take the derivative of 5 to the x, when I take the derivative of just simply, let's make this just a to the x for the generic case of an exponential, not base e, just base a, that is actually the natural log of a times a to the x. Now, the derivative of e to the x is actually just e to the x. Now this came from, I know, quick little review, this came from the fact that f prime of 0, we had shown in our proof of what the derivative of an exponential is, we had shown that an exponential is proportional to itself in its derivative, and it is f prime of 0 times a to the x. And e to the x, it turns out that f prime of 0 is actually equal to 1. We define it that way. Okay, so quick little review as I'm moving along here. When I take the derivative of 5 to the x, we get ln of 5, that's a constant, times 5 to the x, plus 3e to the x, because the derivative of e to the x is just e to the x, and that constant multiples there. And then, of course, the derivative of negative 11 is 0. So you could write plus or minus 0 right there. I'll just write the 0 just to show that it's there. But I'm actually going to, we'll leave it there because we do have one more step to rewrite. So this derivative is 15x to the fourth plus 7 over x squared plus the natural log of 5 times 5 to the x plus 3e to the x, and that is our derivative. So that's a quick review of where we're at. But what if we come across something of this form? So what about something as simple as y equals 5x squared times e to the x? Okay. How do I take that derivative? And I don't actually have the skills to do that yet, or you don't have the skills to do that yet, because this is a product, and while we have talked about sums and differences of two functions and how you can take the derivative of a sum or a difference by taking the derivative of each of the two functions like we did up above here, we have not talked about what do we do with a product. And in fact, that's what we're going to do in this video, and that's what we're going to prove right here, right now. We're going to talk about how do you take the derivative of a product and develop what we call our product rule. So product, let's talk about the product rule. So let's start by saying given two differentiable functions. So given two functions, f of x and g of x that we're multiplying, given two differentiable functions, we'll just call them f of x and g of x. Let's take the derivative of their product. So let's take f of x times g of x. and we're going to show where this comes from. So if we don't know how to take a derivative, we go back to our definition of the derivative. We go back to the limit. So if I've got a product and I want to take the derivative of it, that is going to be equal to, by definition, a limit of f of x plus h times g of x plus h minus f of x times g of x all over h as h goes to 0. So just using my limit definition here. Then I'm going to do a little, because I want to simplify this down, and so this is going to seem possibly like it comes out of nowhere, but I am going to add and subtract something. So I'm not going to change this limit. I'm going to add and subtract something. So I'm really just adding 0. Sometimes we do this in math and it seems like magic. So I'm going to spread this part real quick so that I have a little space. So I'm going to take that quotient, change my color. And what I'm going to do here is I'm actually going to subtract f of x times g of x plus h, and then I'm going to add the same thing, f of x times g of x plus h. So notice right here that this is really just 0. So what I did right there was I really just added 0 because I subtracted and then I added the same thing. Now the reason I did that was because what I wanted to do was I wanted to create a common factor for the grouping of the first two terms in the numerator, and I wanted to create a common factor for the grouping of the second two terms, the second group of terms in the numerator. And so now I'm going to come in and I'm going to say there's a common factor here of g of x plus h, and there's a common factor within these two of f of x. And I'm working my way towards something I can actually evaluate and come up with a rule for this product, the derivative of this product. So I pull that g of x plus h out, and what's left behind up there in the top is an f of x plus h minus f of x. Now, by the way, that looks an awful lot like a derivative, right? It's just missing the division by h, but we are dividing it by h, so we'll come back to that in just a second. Then on the other grouping, I've got that common factor of f of x, so I pull out that common factor of f of x, and I've got a g of x plus h minus g of x. And again, that looks an awful lot like a derivative, right? It looks like the numerator for my definition of the derivative for g is just missing the division by h. But we're dividing this whole thing by h, which means we could divide each of those terms by h. So this could be divided by h, and this could be divided by h. And look at what we're coming up with here. We're coming up with something that's looking an awful lot like two derivatives, the derivative of f of x and the derivative of g of x. Now, there's some other stuff in there too, but notice this piece right here. This is the derivative of f of x. It has the limit here. And this is the derivative of g of x. And so we're going to break this apart into two limits. We're going to say this is the limit as h goes to 0 of g of x plus h times f of x plus h minus f of x, and that is, I'm going to make that bracket actually big, over h, that is the derivative of f, plus, now remember with limits, we can run the limit through this addition, and so this is the limit of f of x times g of x plus h minus g of x over h. And what we have just shown is that the product, and sorry, I'm running into some of my examples down here at the bottom, but we're going to finish this on this next line. What I have just shown right here is that I can now let h go to 0 because this piece is, when I take the limit, this is f prime of x. And when I take this limit, this is g prime of x. Now the rest of it, so as I follow the rest of it out, the limit of g of x plus h, remember we're letting h go to 0, so that goes to 0, so this is g of x times f prime of x, plus, and then of course, as I let h go to 0, f of x doesn't depend on h, so that's just f of x, so this is f of x times g prime of x. Okay? And we have just shown that the derivative of a product, f of x, times g of x, we've just proven what we call the product rule. So we've just proven our product rule. It is a sum of g of x times f prime of x plus f of x times g prime of x. And so we'll summarize that, but let me just write it over here if we wanted to write it in kind of a shorthand. What we have just shown here, let me get it all on the screen here in case you want to freeze that screen for that proof. So there's that proof right there. There's the proof of what we call the product rule. And if we wanted to just summarize it now, we can say this. So we can say, given those two differentiable functions, the derivative of f of x times g of x is actually, and I'm going to rewrite it just slightly, it's f prime of x, I just reorder it, f prime of x times g of x. We take the derivative of f of x, multiply by g of x, and then we add the derivative of g prime of x times f of x. In the proof, I had the f prime and the g flip-flopped and the g prime and the f flip-flopped, but same thing, just using that property of a multiplication where we can, a times b is the same as b times a. Okay, and then shorthand, of course, if we prefer, and sometimes I'll write it this way just to remind us, f times g, right, dropping the actual of x, but understanding f and g are functions, is the same as f prime, it is equal to, by product rule, is equal to f prime g plus g prime f, okay? And this is a rule you have to memorize. We're going to take derivatives for the rest of this course, actually, and for the rest of your calculus career, you're going to be taking derivatives, if there is such a thing as a calculus career. You're going to be taking derivatives, and you're definitely going to encounter products. So you're going to want to know this formula. You have to know this formula. You got to commit it to memory. So however you do that, you know, this is one kind of shorthand. The derivative of f times g is f prime g plus g prime f. That's one way to remember it. And we did prove it. Let's come back over and here's my typed up proof. But here it is in typed up form. If you want to pause, get this into your notes in the nice form here, you can. Now, just as a little note, I do order it slightly differently than some books, including our book, does. I prefer to write it this way because it corresponds a little bit better with the quotient rule, which is the second half of this section. So just so you know, that is my reasoning for why I do write it this way. And if I could get, I think I can get the whole typed up proof and the product rule on the screen at the same time. So if you wanted to, you could freeze that screen and take a look at that. But that is our product rule. So we're going to remember our product rule. If we're taking the derivative of a product, we're going to take the derivative of the first function times the second plus the derivative of the second function times the first. All right. So let's do a couple examples to wrap up this video. So here we go. So here's something very similar to our motivation for why we started this. How do you take the derivative of a product? 3x to the fifth. Actually, it's a product. Technically, it's a product of three things, but one of those is a constant. So I'm going to treat this first factor all as one, just a constant multiple times x to the fifth, and I'm going to treat e to the x as my second. So I know I define this function as f of x, but technically we're thinking of, in terms of our product rule, we're thinking of 3x to the fifth as my f and e to the x as my g. So there is a couple of ways to organize your work here, but I'm going to jump right into the derivative, and I'm going to show if I were to take f prime of x, right, it is a product. So I do want to remember, I'm just going to rewrite it up here so we have it, since I know it's off the screen. If I'm taking the derivative of a prime of f times g, that is f prime times g plus g prime times f. Okay. Another way to write that, of course, is to say if you're taking the derivative of two functions, it's the same as taking the derivative of f times g plus the derivative of g using the derivative operator notation times f. Okay. Okay, so there's our product rule. So when I get in here, I'm going to take the derivative. I need to take the derivative of my first function, so 3x to the fifth. So I'm going to write that in red. Then I'm just going to simply multiply by g of x. So I'm going to multiply by the second function. Then I'm going to add the derivative of the second function, e to the x, times the first function, 3x to the fifth. Okay? And so I'm showing all the steps here. So I'm going to use the derivative operator notation here as I'm writing this out. You could put a little, I guess, a little prime there if you wanted to instead of using the derivative operator. But in notes, I do like to write the derivative operator so that as you're taking notes, you can really be very clear that you're taking a derivative right there. I changed the color as well. And so we're taking the derivative of 3x to the fifth using what we've learned in the previous section about the power rule. So we bring down the 5. So it becomes 3 times 5x to the fourth because we subtract 1. So 3 times 5 is 15, x to the 4 times e to the x plus the derivative of e to the x. This looks kind of, this looks almost like we're not taking a derivative, we're not doing anything, but the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. So this becomes e to the x or is e to the x times 3x to the fifth. And that is our derivative. So we've taken our first derivative of a function that was a product. I do notice, and in terms of simplification, I do want to spend a little bit of time practicing simplification as we're doing these product rules. So let's simplify. So to simplify this, I see that I have a common factor of e to the x, a common factor of x to the fourth, and of 3. So let's pull that common factor out, and we end up with 3x to the fourth times e to the x times, and then what would be left behind is simply 5 plus x. And that is a nice simplified form. If we were to want to do something right here, like say, find where the horizontal tangent lines are, right? Like this is something that we do often and we need to set this equal to 0, for instance. And this is in a form that is a lot nicer, right? This form is just a nicer form to work with. So this is nicer to work with. You know, and my example would be find horizontal tangent lines. You know, if I want to set this equal to 0, this is a really nice form to set equal to 0. Right, we could set it equal to 0, and then it's already in factored form and we could solve.